The Way to God by Dwight L. Moody. To the Reader, from the Original Edition. In this small volume, I have endeavored to point out the way to God. I have embodied in this little book a considerable part of several addresses which have been delivered in different cities, both in Great Britain and in my country. God has graciously used them when spoken from the pulpit, and I trust will nonetheless add His blessing now that they have been put into the printed page with additional matter. I have called attention first to the love of God, the source of all gifts of grace. I have then endeavored to present truths to meet the special needs of representative classes, answering the question, how man can be just with God, hoping thereby to lead souls to Him who is the way, the truth, and the life. The last chapter is specially addressed to the backsliders, a class, alas, far too numerous amongst us. With the earnest prayer and hope that by the blessing of God on these pages, the reader may be strengthened, established, and settled in the faith of Christ, I am, yours in His service, D. L. Moody. Chapter 1. Love That Passeth Knowledge. To know the love of Christ, which passeth knowledge. Ephesians chapter 3, verse 19. If I could only make men and women understand the real meaning of the words of the Apostle John, God is love, I would take that single text and go up and down the world proclaiming this glorious truth. If you can convince a man that you love him, you have won his heart. If we really make people believe that God loves them, how we should find them crowding into the kingdom of heaven. The trouble is that people think God hates them, and so they are all the time running away from Him. A text burned in. We built a church in Chicago some years ago and were very anxious to teach the people the love of God. We thought if we could not preach it into their hearts, we would try to burn it in. So we put right over the pulpit in gas jets these words, God is love. A man going along the streets one night glanced through the door and saw the text. He was a poor prodigal. As he passed on, he thought to himself, God is love. No, He does not love me, for I am a poor, miserable sinner. He tried to get rid of the text, but it seemed to stand out right before him in letters of fire. He went on a little farther, then turned round, went back, and entered the meeting. He did not hear the sermon, but the words of that short text had gotten deeply lodged in his heart, and that was enough. It is of little account what men say if the Word of God only gets an entrance into the sinner's heart. He stayed after the first meeting was over, and I found him there weeping like a child. As I unfolded the Scriptures and told him how God had loved him all the time, although he had wandered so far away, and how God was waiting to receive him and forgive him, the light of the gospel broke into his mind, and he went away rejoicing. There is nothing in this world that people prize so much as they do love. Show me a person who has no one to care for or love him, and I will show you one of the most wretched beings on the face of the earth. Why do people commit suicide? Very often it is because this thought steals in upon them, that no one loves them, and they would rather die than live. I know of no truth in the whole Bible that ought to come home to us with such power and tenderness as that of the love of God, and there is no truth in the Bible that Satan would so much like to blot out. For more than 6,000 years, he has been trying to persuade men that God does not love them. He succeeded in making our first parents believe this lie, and he too often succeeds with their children. When does God love us? The idea that God does not love us often comes from false teaching. Mothers make a mistake in teaching children that God does not love them when they do wrong, but only when they do right. That is not taught in Scripture. You do not teach your children that when they do wrong, you hate them. Their wrongdoing does not change your love to hate. If it did, you would change your love a great many times. Because your child is fretful or has committed some act of disobedience, you do not cast him out as though he did not belong to you. No, he is still your child, and you love him. And if men have gone astray from God, it does not follow that he hates them. It is the sin that he hates. I believe the reason why a great many people think God does not love them is because they are measuring God by their own small rule, from their own standpoint. We love men as long as we consider them worthy of our love. When they are not, we cast them off. It is not so with God. There is a vast difference between human love and divine love. The dimensions of God's love. In Ephesians chapter 3, verse 18, we are told of the breadth and length and depth and height of God's love. Many of us think we know something of God's love, but centuries hence we shall admit we have never found out much about it. Columbus discovered America, but what did he know about his great lakes, rivers, forests, and the Mississippi Valley? He died without knowing much about what he had discovered. So, many of us have discovered.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.